Welcome to Music School for Tomorrow, a three-day virtual symposium developed by the Alliance for the Transformation of Music and Academe, ATMA, in collaboration with the College Music Society. I'm Bill Pelto, Executive Director of CMS, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to this presentation of CMS webinars. As we begin today's conversation, I would welcome all attendees to reflect upon the lands on which we live and work. Each of us, in fact, sits on lands that are historically tied to tribal nations. We acknowledge the harm that this country, a settler colonialist nation, caused by systemically and forcibly removing Indigenous people from their lands. As professional organizations striving to shape our musical worlds as decisively anti-racist, we acknowledge the harms of slavery, white supremacy, and systemic racism tied to the institutions where we conduct our work. We acknowledge that acknowledgement is not in it and of itself enough. Indigenous people still live here. Black and brown people live here. We pay our respects to those and other people of color who, in the face of great harm, continue to make contributions to our institutions and our profession as we strive to lead change that results in more equitable futures while engaging with our exquisite, resilient histories. Before I turn the screen over to our colleagues with ATMA, I want to alert you all to three items of logistics. First, the six sessions of this symposium will be recorded, edited, and posted for public viewing in the CMS library on the College Music Society's website, music.org. Second, please know that attendance at each of the symposium sessions requires separate registration via the College Music Society's event pages. I'll put the link to the registration site in the chat after the session starts. And finally, each day of the symposium will feature an open discussion session at 5 p.m. Eastern time. I'll post the Zoom link to the discussion session in the chat also. Now it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Ed Sereth, founder of the Alliance for the Transformation of Musical Academe. Dr. Sereth serves as a professor of jazz and contemporary improvisation at the University of Michigan, and among other achievements is the author of Black Music Matters, Jazz and the Transformation of Music Studies, published in 2018 by Roman and Littlefield. Ed, welcome to CMS webinars.
Thank you, Bill. I can't be honored enough to convey my, for one thing, my appreciation to be able to collaborate with CMS. CMS is, you know, is like a big pillar in music studies. ATMA is we're a newcomer. A new kid on the block, and here we are. Really, it's so wonderful. And the main thing for the students to step up, Paula Wilson from Indiana, who's facilitating today, Samuel Dunlap from Michigan, Georgia Hears from Oberlin, they're all seniors, they're graduating, and they basically masterminded this event, really spending a lot of time on fine-tuning the questions, selecting the panelists, and it's been really incredibly inspiring. So I thank everyone involved, and I'm gonna turn it over to Paula.
Thank you so much, Professor Sereth. Okay, so I just want to go over a few group norms and agreements for today's conversation. So first of all, if you have any questions for these panelists at any point, feel free to use the Q&A function to ask those questions. As well, we ask for you all to put your university affiliation in your name, kind of like how you see mine. It says Paula Wilson, Indiana University. And in terms of the group agreements, there are four that we have. So the first one is to take the lessons and leave the details. So that is all about what you hear today. Just think about, you know, the lessons from those and not necessarily the specifics when you want to, you know, tell others about this symposium. Just really think about those overarching details and I mean not details overarching points in these discussions. And then the second one is to be open to learning, normalize changing opinions when new information is presented. And that one is all about just being open to everything that the panelists will be saying today. And then the third one is, why am I talking, or wait? And that's and the group agreement mostly for the panelists, just so that we are all making sure that we're staying on topic for today. And then the last one is to be open to someone else speaking your truth. And that's also something that our panelists are considering for when we have brilliant panelists and they're all going to be saying amazing things, and we want to be open and welcoming to those who say what we already agree with. So with that being said, now I will ask Professor Rabideau to introduce himself.
Thank you, Paula. My name is Mark Rabideau. I'm the Associate Dean for Academic and Faculty Affairs within the College of Arts and Media at the University of Colorado, Denver. I'm also the Senior Editor of Emerging Fields, a partnership between the College Music Society and Routledge Publishing. And I am the President of the College Music Society. And I'd like to hand it over to my colleague, Jason Geary.
Thank you, Mark. I'm Jason Geary. I'm Dean of the Mason Gross School of the Arts at Rutgers University. And prior to that, I was at the University of Maryland and the University of Michigan. And so I'm really excited to be with my colleagues here and to be on this panel. I would like to turn it over to my former colleague, Kate Fitzpatrick.
Thank you so much, Dean Geary. Good to see you. Good to see everyone. My name is Kate Fitzpatrick. I am an associate professor of music education at the University of Michigan. Delighted to be here. And coming off a term as Associate Dean for Undergraduate Academic Affairs here at the University of Michigan. And I study issues of marginalization within the field of music education, particularly historically marginalized communities within arts education. I would be more than honored to pass this off to my former teacher, who I am so honored to be on this panel with. Dr. Ted McDaniel was my professor at The Ohio State University. I think I first composed a blues in your class on African-American music, sir, and I also was honored. I wasn't quite good enough to be in your top jazz band at Ohio State, but one concert I got to sit in with all of you. So it is an absolute honor for me to introduce Dr. McDaniel.
Well, thank you so very much, and hello to all. I'm Ted McDaniel. Let me say I've been retired 6 years. I spent 35 years on a faculty at Ohio State, where I held a joint professorship in the School of Music and in the then Department of Black Studies, which became the Department of African American and African Studies. Essentially, I was the African American music and jazz professor. I actually headed the jazz area for 30 years. So I'm just honored to be a part of this assembly and looking forward to today's activities. Let's see, I'm supposed to introduce somebody, Emma. Chris Jenkins, is that right?
That's right, Chris Jenkins, yeah. All right. Thank you very much. So my name is Chris Jenkins. I'm an Associate Dean for Academic Support at Oberlin Conservatory, also the Conservatory Liaison to our Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. I'm also a doctoral student. I'm earning a DMA in viola performance at CIM and a PhD concurrently in musicology at Case Western. So I have a unique perspective, I think, on what's going on right now from that of both a student and an administrator. And I'm really glad to be here with you all. I've met many of the panelists previously, and I look forward to meeting those of you who I have not yet gotten to be acquainted with. I would love to introduce Dr. Sands.
Thank you, Chris, and good morning, everyone. I am the Dean of the School of Fine and Performing Arts at Columbia College, Chicago. That's the last little word you can't see under there. In Chicago, of course. And formerly, I was chair of the music department there and also director of the Center for Black Music Research. And my fields of expertise are in music education. Previously, I served as the coordinator of music education at Cal State Long Beach and the University of Massachusetts Lowell. And I'm very happy to be with everyone this morning. And I think I should ask Christine Goss to introduce herself.
That's actually all of our panelists. Christine is our lovely co-moderator for today. So we can actually get started. All right. So thank you all once again for joining us today. My name is Paula Wilson, and I am a senior at Indiana University. I'm studying flute performance and arts management. And I am also the co-chair for the Alliance for the Transformation of the Musical Academe Student Task Force. And I'm so excited to moderate today's panel discussions. In this session, we will aim to answer the question, how is music conservatory education organized? To clarify, in this context, we are defining conservatory as a school that issues degrees in music, whether it is tied to a larger university or not, unless specified otherwise. You will likely hear conservatory and music school used interchangeably. So the first music school for higher education, the Boston Academy of Music, it was founded in 1833 by Lowell Mason. He's also known as the father of American music education. And there was about 3,000 students who received vocal and instrumental instruction, and they performed ensemble concerts to the public as well. Soon after that, numerous music conservatories developed around the nation. Many were modeled after the Western European institutions. In 1946, the first jazz degree program was created at the University of North Texas. And so fast forwarding to the 21st century, over 26,000 students received a degree in music in 2019. And we have seen numerous innovations and changes in the United States since 1833. So what do these developments look like regarding music academia? In this conversation, we hope to provide a reflection and analysis on the current state of music schools. So we thought it would be best to hear the perspectives of current and former music school deans. And so my first question is for Professor Rabideau. How are music schools structured today? And how would you define its purpose?
Thank you, Paula. Thank you for that broad overview of what we're going to experience over the next 90 minutes. Music schools, I think, will often talk about what makes them distinctive. But what that actually looks like most of the time are discussions about what make them distinguished. Distinguished faculty, distinguished alumni, distinguished concert series. And the truth is that most music schools at the core are quite a lot, quite exactly the same, but just slightly better or slightly worse than the other guy. The same curriculum, degree programs, faculty with similar expertise and pedigree in music theory, music history, music education, and music performance. Students are asked to do the same things, study the same instruments, audition on the same repertoire, use the same set of method books, learn the same excerpts, and embrace the same shared goal of becoming an expert and replicating the past. If I were to ask everyone on this Zoom call today to take one moment and think about the artist from any discipline, genre, or time period, the artist that moves you every time you hear her turn a musical phrase, deliver his poetry, present their choreography, there are two things that we can all be certain about what would transcend from each of the nearly 100 participants in today's call. The artist you chose has a one-of-a-kind voice. They help us see the world from a unique perspective, a one-of-a-kind vantage point, and they have a story. The truth is, we all have a story. What if music schools were to model their programs around the goal of preparing one-of-a-kind artists to the world? Wildly creative, fluent in improvisation, composition, project invention, and musical languages and traditions from across the globe, and equipped to share their one-of-a-kind voice across a horizon of experiences, creating artistic moments one after the next. One way they could do this is to think about music schools as the soundtrack of the communities in which we live, learn, and work. Within this human-centered paradigm, Indiana University Bloomington, where you go, Paula, would attract a very different student clientele than would the University of Texas Austin. And the curricula at Cincinnati Conservatory would be radically different than that offered at San Francisco Conservatory. My hope in a post-pandemic, post-George Floyd world is that we have a clearer vision for the constructs we've created when building and maintaining the silos in which we currently function, and that the pain that we have endured won't be squandered when considering in 2021 whose music matters.
Thank you so much for those amazing words and ideas that we all should consider moving forward. So I would love to direct this next question to Professor McDaniel. And I'm wondering, in our experiences as students, we have found that the majority of our core music classes are white music centric, but the names of these courses do not specify this. For example, a course could be labeled music history, but it's actually teaching Western European music history. If this is the case for your institution, why do you think that is? You're muted.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. My goodness. I almost didn't sleep last night wondering whether or not I would be heard. Let me say that let's begin by talking about what does core mean? Because that's important. If you don't know what core means as a student, you look at a listing of the courses required for your major, you may see a listing of general education, you may see a listing of core, you may see a more specific titled listing of courses that help to define your major. Let's look at core. What does core really mean? Core really means that's the common body of courses that, regardless of your major, be it a bachelor of music degree in percussion or a jazz studies composition or a music ed with a concentration in general music or elementary, secondary, it doesn't matter. The institution implicitly has said that no matter what you study in music, ultimately, you must take the core. You must take the core. Now, let's further define really what that means. The core courses are required. Let's understand what required means. Somebody has decided the essentiality of certain classes is such that regardless of your persuasion or your tendencies or your interests or your desire or your leanings, you absolutely, if you intend to be a learned musician, you must take the core. You must take the core. Now, but we don't really think about that as students. I know I didn't think about it. You know, I was too interested in making out my schedule and trying to get everything to fit to be certain that the courses that truly interested me, that I was able somehow to get into that. But we need to step back sometimes from the microscope of looking at real specific courses to look telescopically at the meaning of this, and so it's important for us to pause to look to see what core means. And the interesting thing about it, I look back on some listings here the last several days thinking about this topic, and let me take music history, because that's always in the core. You can't study music in college without studying music history. And you look at a typical listing and it says music history 1, music history 2, music history 3, sometimes music history 4. And then you wonder, okay, what does that really mean? Well, I don't know, somebody has decided that That's all the information that you need. Perhaps there is a belief that we all need to have the same history, or that we've all had the shared history. Generally, you can't teach what you don't know, and you usually teach what you do know, and that typically means that teachers teach what they have been taught. And so there is this perpetuating situation that permeates virtually all institutions of degree-granting music, particularly in America. And what that translates to, I would imagine 90% of the time, is the Western, what some call classical music or art music canon. That's essentially what it means. And that is significant. That is significant. If I might just use a kind of personal situation here. While I was happy as a clarinetist, that was my first instrument to study Mozart and Brahms. I mean, the clarinet wouldn't even be mentioning that instrument if it weren't for those two composers. I mean, everybody has to, if you're gonna study clarinet, you gotta do the Mozart clarinet concerto, and you gotta do the two Brahms sonatas amongst many other great works. That's not a negative statement, by the way, it's just a fact. But that was a part of the requirement. Nobody, listen to me, nobody required me to study Louis Armstrong. Nobody required me to put the microscope on Charlie Parker. Nobody required me and said that, Ted, in order for you to do what you really want to do in this big wide world called music and become literate and learn all that you can, nobody said, man, you got to understand the guy that became your main man, John Coltrane. So what I'm suggesting here, just to get the conversation started here, is this kind of hidden hierarchy of values, of significance, of importance, imposed on us by institutions. And they all do it. So in summary here on this point, and I'm sure I would imagine later on in the Q&A, we'll have some further opportunity to talk about this, is this imposed kind of importance. What does required versus elective mean? And I'll rest my point at this time. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that. And Professor Sands, do you have anything you'd like to add to that?
Thank you, Paula. Yeah, I would actually like to sort of piggyback on one of the examples that Ted brought up about music history. Because we were talking about how these courses are named and how they are titled. And certainly one of the naming conventions in music history courses has been to reveal that it's a chronological approach. So we get music history one, you know, from antiquity. We don't know whose antiquity it is until you get there the first week, but from antiquity to 1750 or something of that nature. So that's one thing. I did find one example where someone, I think it was a school in New Jersey, who described their music history one as the history and development of styles, forms, and genres and composers of the Western intellectual heritage. So they at least put it out there. This is what we're looking at, you know. It wasn't, you know, they didn't hide it in that way, but still it identifies what music they felt was important to be covered, whose history of music was important to be covered. I wanted to give just one example of a different approach to a music history course that actually is present on my campus. We changed the name of our base undergraduate music history courses a few years ago to calling them simply music, time, and place. And so we're looking at music across time. We're looking at music in different places. We're not privileging a particular provenance. We're not privileging a particular culture, but it's a diverse approach to the history of music, but across different times and across different places. And so we have that series. That's the way we've been offering the music history. I was chair when that was proposed. It wasn't my course. And I remember thinking, oh, but it doesn't say history. I mean, I was sort of stuck. Did we have to call it music history? But it's actually worked out well. And students are introduced to the history of musical sound, but again, with a broader approach and a more inclusive approach. So I just want, that was my comment, further comment on what Ted was discussing.
Yeah, that's great. And that actually led me to a different question. Based off of that course, Music, Time, and Place, I'm curious, you know, when we start adding different cultures into this curriculum, we're still bound to exclude other cultures. I mean, we only have, you know, a semester for these courses. Professor Rabideau, do you have something you'd like to say? How can we include, you know, all of these different cultures? Like, what is the approach to that?
You're right. It often the argument is, so what am I going to get rid of in order to put something new in? Which is a dead end start. That perhaps people choose to start that way because they know it's a dead end, or the constructs have confined them in such ways that they can't even imagine asking a different question. I'll answer that in a little different way. I would love to offer two courses in music history, and I'd follow Duke Ellington's lead, who famously said there are simply two kinds of music, good music and the other kind. And I'd offer the good kind of music history and the other kind of music history, or we'd even call it the bad music history, and we'd see where people would enroll. We could do this for our degree programs as well. You could study good music in this degree program. You could study, I think what we would see is that people would come to the good music, and the good music is gonna come up, I think, later in our discussion as we talk about defining excellence. But the truth is that we need to look deep into the concepts that will spark students' imaginations and give them the tools, as Ted, my colleague, Professor McDaniel, talked about so beautifully, is to follow their, lean into their spark. What is it that they're passionate about? Where do they imagine their future? I asked the question, everyone on this, in the Zoom room, thought about the artist that they loved most. You know, what would that person look like? It would look like everything from Duke Ellington to Amadeus Mozart, to Jimi Hendrix, to Joni Mitchell, to so many artists. So let's learn the skills that empower us to find our one-of-a-kind voice. And that is not found within any one culture. And it doesn't have to start with what do you want to get rid of? You have to ask yourselves, what do students need to become artists to the world?
Absolutely. And Professor Jenkins, did you want to add something to that?
Yeah, just really quickly to add on to that, you know, I think when we're talking about music school for tomorrow, when we're talking about transforming conservatory education in America, we're talking about what a culturally responsive pedagogy should look like in an America that's not just more diverse, but is majority minority. What does a culturally responsive pedagogy look like in a majority minority America? So if you're teaching a music history course and you're expecting that a larger percentage, perhaps a majority of your students will be Black or Latinx, what perspective makes sense to teach your course, right? How do you transform your perspective? It's not a matter of adding or subtracting things. It's a matter of transforming the perspective so as to better reflect the larger viewpoint of a majority minority America. And so it is true that that is going to be, I think, the real fight that we will be engaging in the next few decades, how to actually transform perspectives, because that's a real sticking point for many people.
Yes, definitely. And, you know, when we're talking about pedagogy and, you know, changes within that, I'm curious on, and I think I will ask Professor Fitzpatrick this, on what is considered or what should be considered musical excellence.
Thank you so much. Musical excellence, I think, is a boundary word that we are currently using to exclude a lot of the musics, a lot of the people that belong in our institutions and can help transform our institutions. Musical excellence at its basis shouldn't be a problematic thing, but we have to look at the fact that the way we have traditionally in our institutions defined musical excellence, it becomes that gatekeeper word. When we have discussions about what we're going to do and what we're going to change, people always tend to bring up that question of, well, but how will we make sure that everyone is attending to musical excellence? And again, I think that's why we need to step back. I mean, this is a point of time right now that hopefully will be truly exciting, because what we are engaged in right now is questioning the previously unquestioned in our institutions. And for so long, we have all just gone along with that status quo of who we are and what we serve. And the acknowledgement that we're addressing really just a tiny sliver of what music can mean in the broader society is really, really important. But if we take a look at what we're doing within our schools, there are some fundamental questions I think we have to ask. And luckily, I will say, you know, again, there are amazing students leading this group and this particular set of webinars. Our students are really the ones leading the charge right now to question the unquestioned and to lead us to these spaces. And I think we owe them a tremendous debt of gratitude. At Michigan this in the fall, we had an outpouring of beautifully transformative demands from our students. And I think that is just a wonderful thing that hopefully will lead us to positive spaces in the future. But I think we have to question, when we look at musical excellence, what do we teach in the first place? And we've been talking about that with regards to the so-called core or required curriculum, but also who's at the table in the first place, right? So who is at the table in terms of our faculty who are able to teach diverse forms of music? Who are our students? And that asks us profound questions of access and barriers and equity in the first place. And also that portion of things, which is how do we actually serve students when they come to our institutions, right? So that culture and climate issue, which so many of our students of color have been telling us for many years, that they have experienced really negative climates and culture, particularly when they are not well represented amongst faculty and students. So I think we have a lot of places to look at. When we talk about culturally responsive pedagogy, we talk frequently, and I've written about this in music education, we talk frequently about the music we do, right? And sure, that's part of it, right? Like making sure there's been great progress. We're not there yet, but there's been great progress in acknowledging diversity amongst composers and performers. Those are important questions. But the other part of that is how are we transforming our spaces, right? How are we going deeper and doing the deep work so those musics don't exist in spaces where people are not represented? There are spaces that we are trying to deconstruct from the profoundly systematically racist past that we have within broader society. Higher education is not separate from that past. So I think we have to do that profound and deep work now to be transformative. Yes, let's change the content and the musics. Let's also try to transform our spaces and the people at the table.
Thank you so much, Professor Fitzpatrick. And then Jason, would you like to add anything?
Yeah, I would. I just want to note that I think it's important too, that we begin to think about the distinction between, you know, what we might call, what is often called musicality and proficiency, right? So, I mean, generally speaking, the way that our, you know, audition requirements are laid out, and the way in which we evaluate, you know, the students that we're going to accept into our spaces, we're looking really at, you know, the question of not a kind of inherent or innate, you know, musicality or ability to, you know, think and imagine or create aesthetically, but rather the sort of proficiency of a trajectory, a course of study that is part of what, you know, puts up those gates that Professor Fitzpatrick was referring to. And so I think I would like to see more robust discussion and thought you know, sort of as a community around really defining, right, what are and how do we sort of tease apart that distinction and, you know, and begin to think about, you know, what comprises these, you know, these values or and these qualities. And, you know, I think that I think Mark too kind of alluded to a little bit of that and, you know, referencing kind of the experience of, you know, one's favorite artist and, you know, good music and these sorts of things. We need to kind of get behind and think about those, you know, the sort of foundations of these concepts, I think, in deeper and more introspective ways. And that I think will help to begin to kind of separate out and to disentangle these, you know, notions of, you know, something that we sort of recognize as being in some respects ineffable, but also I think can be defined, and what we tend to think of as proficiency that leads to and is part of the gatekeeping that I think is so problematic.
Yeah, thank you so much. Professor Rabideau?
Yeah, I don't want to say too much here, but I would love to see a radical reimagining of the you know, the measurements of it. And it'd be something in my mind as simple as excellence, and you get maybe three grades for it. A grade in curiosity, what's your ability to stretch beyond your own boundaries of knowledge? A grade in creativity, what's your willingness to explore beyond that which you already know? And collaboration, how do you engage others in solving problems that are not yet solved? So I think there are many ways to flip this thing around, but we do seem to stay in the same few loops. It's gonna be hard to break.
Yeah, Professor McDaniel.
Yeah, yeah, let me just hop in on this. This is so exciting. Thank you, Kate, for sparking my thoughts here and the others of you. Excellence is a very interesting word. And in the field of music, you know, we have this juxtaposition of the eye versus the ear. Okay, that is important. And both are important. I mean, we talk about music literacy and you know, we might agree that any really good musician has to have a good ear. And it helps, there are advantages to having a good eye. Reading music is advantageous in some circumstances. Now, we have a body, you know, we have a whole genre of music that we now study inside the academy, for which the Western system of notation does not begin to accommodate. Let's admit that. It's called jazz. I deal with it every day of my life, okay? And it is confounding, it is baffling. You know, we tend to be in the music school at kind of one and two and three and four, and yet we study a whole lot of music that is shifty. The accents are falling all over the place. What we see on paper is not how we have to interpret it. What we hear, And I'm talking about jazz because that's the area that I specialize in for the most part. The writing of it is challenging because we are trained to use the ear. In that sense, the ear probably is far more important for a quote unquote jazzer than the eye, in the sense that we tend to model and we tend to learn from primary sources. I mean, I do a lot of transcribing. In my early career, I did a ton of that stuff. And after a while, I just kind of gave up on it because there were some limitations in it. I can only represent it. I can only approximate, you know, I can only approximate what I was hearing. And then that becomes a kind of pedagogical issue in the academy. And anybody who teaches in jazz studies understands that. So I just merely want to point out we still have much work to do as we become more inclusive because of the diversity of our societies and our willingness to expand our reach and to bring into this academy traditions and cultures that have been, for the most part, outside of the academy when it came to serious inquiry and serious study.
Yeah, thank you. And then we have a question that ties in pretty well to this from the Q&A box, so I'll go ahead and ask it. It's from Glenn Holtzman, and the question is there a place for a music student who only ever is able to play by ear but struggles to develop literacy skills because of no prior formal training in childhood or adolescent years? We have a struggle in South Africa whereby Black students are especially seen as lesser than. And if there's anyone in particular that would like to address that question, sure, Professor Sands.
Let me say this, that I was going to say that it is very problematic the way we admit students and the way we assess them. And so we tend to assess them based on a deficit model, that is what they are not able to do. We need to look more at what they bring to us. Now, I'm actually from an institution where we don't audition our students. They self-declare as music majors. We do assess them, so we know where to place them in terms of theory. We don't even call it music theory anymore. We do assess them, but we get many students who are what I call pre-readers, because in our program, they do have to learn to read music to earn the degree. But we accept them into the program and we work with them, and we believe we have the support in place to help move them from where they are to where they need to be. Now, for some of them, it may take a little longer. It may take some summer study or something of that nature, but we have had success with admitting students into our program, which, by the way, I should also say, disclaimer, is not based on Western music or European classical music foundation. It's mainly a focus on popular and contemporary music. That's what we do at Columbia College Chicago. So we've had success with students who not come from school music programs, meaning they don't read, but they've been playing and singing in their church choirs. They're skilled enough on the keyboard that when a minister in a Black church starts singing, they can find the key and start accompanying them. They come with those kinds of skills. But yes, we put them in, I would say, a fairly traditional program, except it focuses a lot on popular and contemporary music. And we move them from where they were to being able to earn the degree. Not everybody gets through the program, and some students come in and say, it's not quite what I thought I was going to be doing. So we do lose some, but we do have a measure of success with students who come in as pre-readers, are not able to read music at all because they've not had any kind of formal training, but who are able to progress and earn the degree in the field.
Yeah, that is pretty cool. Thank you. We're having quite a few questions coming into the panel, so we're gonna let those build up for a little bit, and I'm gonna ask a few more questions of the panelists. So I want to ask Professor Jenkins this question. So many educational institutions in the United States exclude musicians from diverse backgrounds in their course content and ensemble program. And we have touched on this a little bit. And so do you see this as a missed opportunity? And if so, what are some ways that institutions could start working towards diversifying their courses, programming, and student body? And with the emphasis on the student body?
That's a great question. And so, you know, my observation has been that institutional efforts to diversify have focused mostly on demographic diversity within the student body and somewhat within the faculty body. And then we're just now in the past 18 months seeing more movement towards diversifying curriculum. But the focus has really been on recruiting and retaining more students of color with the notion that that is the definition of diversity in conservatories. And I would submit that that is not at all the definition of diversity. It's only one element in a project that will involve really a reimagining of everything that we do, the psychological environment of the conservatory. So, you know, there are many aspects of the conservatory environment that are oriented toward designed by and for a white majority. And you can think of these in a variety of ways. I tend to frame them as aesthetics, but the interactions between people, the kinds of clothing that students are expected to wear, the kind of writing students are expected to do. And you know, the thing is that there's a lot of research done on this outside of conservatories. There's research on how misinterpretation of behavior by white teachers in K-12 education of Black student behavior affects outcomes. There's research into how Black students modulate their own behavior, sometimes in negative ways, in mixed race schooling environments, right? There's research into how the academic style of writing that's required even in high school is aesthetically white and alienating to other constituencies, and how there is such a thing as, for example, Black rhetoric that is a different writing style that is not accepted in academia. We don't talk about these things in the conservatory. So really, I think drilling down fundamentally on what we mean by diversity, besides just the color of the people in the room, how does the environment function? What are the expectations for personal behavior and academic behavior that are judged as being of quality, right? All of these things are aesthetically limited and culturally determined. So I think we really need that much more, it's both broader and more granular at the same time. We need that kind of really expansive view if we're actually going to become more diverse, because it goes way beyond the color of the students in the room. It goes way beyond the color of the composers being programmed. Those things are important. Those things are stepping stones on a pathway to actually reconfiguring how the environment functions and what the expectations are, because it's those little elements of individual interaction, microaggressions, right? Those expectations that are culturally disjunct for students of color that end up creating, environments that are not welcoming, right? What we call poor climate, right? This is a euphemism for what I'm talking about, a poor climate. So thinking in this much more expansive way that views demographic diversity and programming diversity and pedagogical diversity as all as elements of a much larger project in which we're reimagining psychologically how the environment functions.
Yeah, that's great. And to add on to that, I'm curious if any of you have either examples within your own institution or anything that you've seen of an institution that is working towards this, you know, the sort of cultural shift, cultural change. And if not, can anyone give specifics, I guess, of what that can look like?
Paula, I'll just say, I think all of our institutions, to some degree or another, are no longer avoiding this point. The big question in my mind is, how fast can we run the race where we'll somehow unimaginably, but perhaps it could happen, you know, that people think this moment has passed and we go back to business as usual, whatever that looks like. I'm praying that's not the case, or if scholars like Professor Jenkins can get that word out there in a broad enough way that gives kind of a comprehensive guide towards how each institution can uniquely take up these charges. And I only wanted to say that in getting to the point we're saying the Emerging Fields in Music sent a contract to Professor Jenkins this week, which I understand he signed, which is why I'm being nice to him on this panel today, to author a book, a lead book, on this subject of whose music matters and how might we reimagine not just our pedagogies and our curricula offerings, but really, you know, the ways in which we present ourselves as music schools. Professor Sarath was also offered a book contract. I don't think he signed it yet, so he needs to get on that for the same topic. And there are a number of other books that will be forthcoming in the same collection. And so it's important for us all to think about this, but to turn to experts like those that I've referenced here to look for some insight and guidance.
And Professor Jenkins?
Yeah, just to give a little follow-up to what I'm speaking of, I'm referring to the assimilationist pressures that are brought to bear on students of color in conservatories, in environments that are designed by and for a white majority. And then in conservatories, we have an additional cultural element in that the approach to music making, to music study, what's focused on, the approach is also aesthetically and culturally limited. So all elements of the environment serve to, in a certain way, delegitimize the cultural identity of some students of color, all those elements together. So if we're talking about being more diverse and having more diverse student bodies, we really owe it to those students to, rather than trying to assimilate them, trying to integrate our conservatory experience.
Yeah, this somewhat leads into a question that we got from the Q&A, and it says, what strategies have you found to be effective when talking with colleagues in music departments or conservatories who are resistant to these kinds of changes?
Well, I'll just say, I mean, I think that's you know, having these kinds of transformative impacts is a challenging thing. But one question that I just like to ask when we're in discussions, you know, is, are we preparing students for how things have been, or are we preparing them to lead in, you know, the world of tomorrow in arts, in the arts? And again, there are some generational issues here that are at play where our students are really ahead of many of all of us, right, in higher education. And so I think it's really important for us to realize that maintaining the status quo is going to leave our students unprepared for what is to come, right? There is a new world to prepare for, and we're all gonna be stuck if we don't address this. So there's an imperative now, and I think, again, helping colleagues really focus on our students is a place to go there, right? And also just trying to challenge the defensive posture that comes up, I think, in discussions. I think that's the first thing that tends to happen. And I think we have to understand that, you know, all of us in higher ed are victors of the current system, right? All of us have navigated this system well, or we wouldn't be here. So we are limited in our ability to envision what a different system might look like. And starting from that perspective of digging deep and saying that we might not have all the answers here, decentering ourselves, humbling ourselves, and asking questions, imagining alongside and with our students and future leaders, I think those are promising ways that we can start to deconstruct this. Organizational change, I mean, there's a lot of literature out there. It is a complicated process, and we move in stages, and sometimes there are very surface level things that start to happen. But doing that deeper work requires all of us, I think, to really consider inward on our own journeys what we're doing on behalf of our students and what they need.
Thank you. I see Professor McDaniel, but Professor Geary, would you like to answer?
Yes, I just wanted to sort of add on to that and say that Kate's absolutely right, that we are, you know, we are products of the system, as it were, And that, I think, is where a lot of the anxiety in having these conversations comes from, right? That, you know, faculty colleagues contemplate change and often see themselves or imagine themselves written out of that change, right? And so that comes, I think, from a, you know, a real genuine place of, you know, a fear and anxiety. And so part of it is, you know, in some ways, I'm thinking of the example that Mark gave when he was talking about curriculum and moving away from this sort of binary opposition of, if, you know, if you add that, what do you take away? That, you know, we have to begin to think in ways that are more expansive, more capacious in terms of the musics that, you know, that we engage with and help our colleagues to understand that in expanding that tent, that doesn't necessarily mean eliminating, you know, much of what we do and much of what our colleagues do, but it is thinking about ways in which we, you know, build structures that expand, you know, expand our schools and our options, and particularly those of students.
Great. Professor McDaniel? You're muted.
Okay. Are you able to hear me now? Sorry. I just wanted to add on sharing. You ask about strategies. I remember several years ago now, I was bothered by the fact that my colleagues on the faculty in the School of Music, particularly my music education faculty colleagues, seemed to be comfortable with sending really talented students out in the schools, even into many urban districts, not having had any formal training in Black music. And since I taught one of those courses in the school, I talked to a couple of my closest colleagues on the music ed faculty and called their attention to it and finally was able to persuade them to how I was thinking about it, which I'm happy to say they did agree with, but they were a bit reluctant and apprehensive to do anything about it. So I ended up writing a letter to the head of the area asking for a meeting. And later I was invited to go before the entire music ed faculty to say, listen, my goodness, these students need some formal training in the tradition. I mean, they're going out into these urban schools. Many of the schools were predominantly Black or increasingly Latin, increasingly other minorities, and so on. It took me 5 years, just about 5 years, but eventually I got the requirement where if you were a music ed major, you would be required to take a semester of my African-American music history course. And that was just a start, but that was the strategy at the time. I was in the jazz studies area. I was not a member of the music ed faculty, but I had to go to my music ed colleagues and say, listen, you can't look in the mirror and continue doing what you are doing and not make some change.
Thank you. All right, so we have hit the time where we're going to start answering more of the attendees' questions. And so I'm gonna start with a question from Eric Hung, who is the Executive Director of Music of Asian American Research Center. And it says, I have heard a lot of discussion about diversity in this discussion. But to paraphrase Angela Davis, no one marching on the street is demanding diversity. They're demanding justice. So what would a just music education look like?
Great question.
I'll jump in if that's okay. Just because I have some particular some strong opinions on this issue in particular, and one of them being that if the American Conservatory is, as I think Dr. Rabideau actually asserted, supposed to reflect the soundtrack of the community in which it's located, if writ large the American Conservatory program ought to reflect the cultural values of a more diverse America as we diversify, then it strikes me that foundational courses in Black music, Black American music, ought to be a requirement in every conservatory. Black American music being one of the most significant cultural products of America, globally popular, has influenced music the world over, and yet it's totally marginalized in our own music education system, right? In higher education. It's marginalized as in it's to the side, it's not centralized. And why we would not centralize such a fundamental component of American life. We hear African American music every day, all the time. We all do. You can hardly escape it. And yet we don't learn how to study it. It's not required. That to me is a foundational change that ought to happen.
I saw two hands at once. Professor Sands, we'll start with you.
I totally agree with that, but I want to say also, in addition to a course or distinctive course or courses, Black music content needs to be embedded across the curriculum so that the examples that are used to illustrate and demonstrate different concepts in music theory courses, Black music is represented there. The examples that they're using in all of the musicianship courses or history courses, Black music needs to be represented there as well. So you get the deep, you know, the deep dig into that body of music in a distinct course, but you are encountering it in other places across the curriculum, in the studios of the repertoire that's assigned, in the repertoire across performing ensembles. The music of Black composers needs to be there. So everybody leaves, everybody who's leaving that school with that degree has exposure and has worked deeply with Black music content. I absolutely believe that's important as well.
And Professor Fitzpatrick?
Yes, thanks. And I also think it's really, thank you so much. I also think it's really important, the ecosystem of arts education and higher ed cannot be detached from the ecosystem of K through 12 music education. And that's something that within our field of music education, we are working hard to address many of these issues too. But I think it's really important to point out that in our country, the zip code that you grow up in still depends what kind of a music education you get, right? And so when we look at broader arts equity, that's a piece of this puzzle that does affect us in higher education. And it might be, you know, sometimes we think of it as the chicken and the egg. Do we need to fix this before we get to this? It's both, right? We have to fix both at the same time, but we can't leave that PK through 12 arts education ecosystem out there. Equity within music education and arts education is fundamentally important to changing many of these issues long-term.
Great, thank you so much. I have a question for Professor Geary. It's music skills tend to have a more strict structure in nature. Do you think this prevents students from exploring musical careers outside of the predetermined degree paths?
So yeah, thanks. So I think the short answer to that is yes. But what to me this question raises is the issue of infrastructure. That's a word we've been hearing a lot recently on the news and in political context, but I think it's really important here. And that is that I don't think that we can begin to talk in realistic ways about really remaking, dismantling the structures that undergird music schools and conservatories without thinking about and dismantling the infrastructure that supports them. And I'll give you an example. So at many of the schools represented here by this panel, large ensembles, and in particular the orchestra, plays an outsized role in terms of the activities that students are involved in, resources, time, scheduling, space, the list goes on and on. And it also is part of a sort of phenomenon whereby our curricula and our schools are for the most part set up to create clones of the faculty that teach at those schools, right? In other words, they're designed with kind of an endpoint in mind, that endpoint being that we're going to train you to look like we do, and we're going to train you to prepare for careers that, you know, those faculty who have been successful, and that's why they're in those positions, that sort of trajectory and the paths that they have pursued. And that approach is very limiting, right? And it's restricting in terms of opportunities for students and curricula and programming and so on. And it becomes a real issue of infrastructure, because, you know, I've heard from so many students, especially at the graduate level, but even at the undergraduate level, who have said that they don't want to be an orchestra, that they want to pursue other paths, they want to pursue other opportunities within music, and yet they're required to be an orchestra. And so there's a kind of tension that exists between that desire for flexibility that so many of us express, and so many of our institutions do, and the desire to think beyond what established norms are and what traditions are, and the need to have certain ensembles, for example, or the perceived need to have certain ensembles, for example, the orchestra, because what that means is you need a certain number of students in order to be able to field an orchestra. And so what you wind up doing then is using a lot of resources and putting a lot of energy and time into creating that infrastructure and allowing those experiences to happen for those students who want them. And no doubt there are many, and some of our students are wanting to pursue that trajectory, but it becomes that sort of inherent tension between how you allow the kind of flexibility and openness that we've been discussing without, in some fundamental ways, dismantling this infrastructure that undergirds so many of our institutions. So I think that's a big part of what is, sort of holding students back from being able to explore, and for that matter, holding faculty and administrators back from really being able to move beyond the status quo.
Right, that makes a lot of sense. Professor Jenkins, did you want to add something to that?
Yeah, I'm so glad that you mentioned that, Dr. Geary, the nature of the large ensemble. Just to expand on that point, because I think students really don't understand the extent to which the large ensemble dictates so much of the institution. Literally, you know, as Dr. Geary mentioned, the students that we have to admit students that can fill out a full orchestra. And when we're talking about a full orchestra, we're really talking about a late 19th century romantic orchestra that can play Wagner, can play Brahms, and that ensemble itself is socially constructed, it has certain social meaning, and aesthetically and culturally limited. Yet, it dictates who we must hire as faculty, because if we have to have the students to fill out the orchestra, we must have the faculty. It dictates our faculty lines, it dictates then also what we teach in music theory, because if the central focus of the institution is to field this orchestra, then we have to analyze that music. So everything ends up folding around this single institution. I don't mean to throw the orchestra under the bus, I apologize, but this is just the reality of how our institutions work, of how conservatories work. So getting away from that model in some way is a really important part of diversifying.
Yes, it goes back to what Professor McDaniel was saying about the core and what is the core. So moving on to the next question, this is from Christian Aaron King from the University of Michigan. So they're saying that my thoughts about musicality is that the current academic musical culture is that musicality is something that's done to by you, unquote. But the reimagining of music studies would benefit from musicality being something that is done with or within you, because that organically nurtures both individuality and collaboration. What are your thoughts?
Let's do that.
Yeah. Anyone? Oh, did I see? Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, yeah, absolutely, let's do that. And I think it ties back to what I said about assessing students based on their deficiencies instead of what they bring. So look at what their strengths are, what they come with, and work with them to further expand that, to further build that out. And that might be more improvisation and opportunities for them to improvise, et cetera, but building on what they innately bring with them when they come to us, instead of just saying what they don't have and what needs to be fixed. So I think some of that is starting to happen.
Professor Rabideau?
Yeah, this is not answering that question in its entirety, and it's a great point. It's interesting how many of the last few subjects come back to a single word for me it's two words, repositioning creativity. If we reposition creativity as the most important goal of a music education, the Black experience would be at the center of that, right? And as many, many global traditions would, right? So many global traditions are built around that individual creativity and collaborative creativity. The kind of the dominance of large ensemble, that in many ways is the antithesis of individual creativity. It's collective expression, often guided by an individual on a podium. But you know, we talk about the silos and how we would feel restricted and limited and all these things. That's the opposite of creativity. So we've gotten extraordinarily good at recreativity, and we've narrowed the very definition of whose music we hope to recreate in such a fine way that everything from a student's perspective of what I audition on and what's acceptable on a graduate, graduate doctoral recital, or what a faculty member's job description is on the way in, how they'll be evaluated through tenure, promotion, et cetera. I mean, all of that is so limited. And in so many ways, if we could reposition creativity at the center of all that we do, so many of these things would be very, very different than what we have now.
Thank you. And this next question is also kind of talks to the core of music. And it's asking, what would the panelists think about the nuclear option for core music history and music theory in the conservatory? So that would mean replacing core classes with a list of options. This might allow students to pursue individual desires and interests, but it would perhaps undermine a sense of common purpose. Is the whole idea of core outdated?
I would tend to think that it is. I would love to imagine a conservatory environment in which requirements could be satisfied by diverse electives such that you could study, say, almost nothing other than Black music and graduate. And why not, right? Why not be able to study jazz and hip hop and rock and classical music, the Black elements of those, and graduate with a degree? Why not? The fact that we're so far from that indicates how far we really have to go. But you know, I would say that also we should be re-envisioning how we think about music theory versus music history and moving more towards a music studies approach in which we're not siloing all of these things off, but we're integrating more how we approach learning about music history and performance. There's no reason why we shouldn't be performing in theory classes, why we shouldn't be analyzing it in history classes, right? The siloing off is just a function of how academia works today, and we're just recreating it instead of finding a way to cut that off and start something new.
It'd be a lot to ask the experts in one discipline to actually imagine themselves in another space, and that's perpetuating the problem.
Does anyone else want to add to that? Professor Sands?
So let me just say quickly, I already revealed the fact that I'm from a music department that is focused on popular and contemporary music. And I should, and so a lot of what you're talking about is happening in that curriculum. They no longer have oral skills or air training courses separate from written theory courses. It's all combined. It's not just separate composition courses, but improvisation is included. And this is now housed in a part of the curriculum called Foundations of Music. So, and it's not just, it also includes performance. So it's a big lecture group, and then they break into small groups. They do performance, they do improvising, et cetera. And the music that is brought in is very, very inclusive and diverse. So it crosses styles and genres. So all of that is happening at Columbia College Chicago in the music department. But I will say this, we are not NASM accredited. And so accreditation is sometimes a barrier. It's an impediment because accreditation with NASM has been fairly conservative and rather traditional. But other schools that have gone the path, well, before us, I also was an adjunct professor at Berklee College of Music. Berklee was never NASM accredited as well. I don't know, now that they're connected to New England Conservatory, they might be, I'm not sure. There was a merger a few years ago. But for schools, there's a certain level of freedom where you can make these kinds of changes when you're not necessarily bound to meeting the standards of an accrediting agency. So I think sometimes that can be an impediment there.
Thank you. And you somewhat touched on a question. We'll go back to that after we hear from Professor Geary.
Actually, I was going to sort of address that point and the question. You want to read the question?
Yes, awesome. All right, so this is coming from Benjamin Brand from the University of North Texas. And it says, fairly or not, NASM, the National Association of Schools of Music, is often characterized as a barrier to curricular change. What role and should NASM play in developing more inclusive and equitable music programs?
Yeah, so I think that's absolutely right that I've on more than several occasions have been in conversations with my colleagues talking about the possibility of you know, expanding options or moving away from the core, and will often hear NASM brought up as a as a stumbling block there. I would say a couple of things. One is that that's often not true. And that, if you look carefully at the standards in the NASM handbook, what you often find is that they are emphasizing competencies, and they're not often, I think there are some exceptions, but they're not often saying how you have to attain or show that those competencies have been met. So there's more flexibility, I think, just as one point here, as a sort of starting point, than I think folks often understand when it comes to NASM. But the other thing I would say is that, you know, what is that organization other than a, you know, collection of individuals such as the ones here on this panel, and you know, we can expand that to include our you know, various faculties and on and on. So if the values we've been discussing and the change that we've been sort of pointing toward, if this collectively, if these are the directions in which we want to move, then it does become incumbent to be having those conversations, not just in forums like this, not just among our own faculty, but also in accrediting bodies like NASM as well. So that there's a, you know, that it's happening sort of in tandem, right? Those conversations are happening in those large accrediting bodies. They're happening outside of them. And there's a sort of recognition and appreciation for the inherent flexibility within many of those quote unquote requirements. So I think that there is a role for NASM to play, and there is a way in which we get to where we'd like to be without, as it were, throwing out the baby with the bathwater.
Just echoing, we should not look to NASM to lead. That's what ATMA and the College of Music Society does. But we should shape the policies.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, and actually there was a question about that from Jane Palmquist, and she was wondering if any institutions have adopted the CMS TFUM manifesto. So Professor Rabideau, if you could outline, that manifesto and also answer the question.
I should not outline that manifesto, as the principal author is lurking in the shadows here, Dr. Ed Sarath. But I think so many of the things that there he is. I'm just going to drop the mic here and let him take.
Sounds good.
Just really quickly on that, the CMS manifesto is arguably, but like when it went viral, none of us thought it would go viral. Thank you for bringing that up. It really raises the bar way higher than it's being read. I mean, the CMS manifesto has been a lot of talk about it, and people really need to dig deep into the positioning of Black American music in that. Nobody's talking, even people that are waving the manifesto flag, nobody is talking about the place of Black American music, which resonates with a lot of the commentary here. So this question of what schools are really doing it, I think that vision is really big, and we need to keep working in that direction. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. All right. So we are approaching our final minutes. So I want to give the panelists a chance to say any final words that they might have, whether it be words of advice to people that are on the call, for next steps towards change in these institutions. Does anyone have anything they'd like to contribute?
I think Ted's trying to say something, so I'll let Ted. Ted, you're muted though.
Just simply, Black music really does matter, so continue to fight.
And I was just going to add that I think I want to thank everyone who organized this for putting this panel together, because I think this is where so much of the change happens. Having these conversations, really airing, concerns, anxieties, questions. And I think it's important that, the dialogue that we've seen here and the questions that have been raised are ones that we're having on our own campuses, particularly those of us who are in leadership positions and students. I mean, I think Kate said it best that the students are so often out in front of us. And this is I think that the change and the future of music conservatories and schools is a perfect example of that. And really engaging with our students and having robust conversations, I think is a really important place for us to be. So I think this conversation and the really I think thoughtful comments that we've been getting are all indicative of the direction in which we're moving, and I think change often feels glacial. And I know that Ed and others are doing what they can to make that less so, but I think this is an important part of the process.
One thing I just wanted to jump in really quick. My name is Samuel. I helped kind of organize this. Before people start to kind of leave, I want to just say that we're going to have a follow-up meeting at 5 p.m. and really like think about where we're going with this, right? Because this conversation is just the beginning, and it's incredible. We have 82 people here today, and we have 6 more conversations coming. So stay tuned and come by at 5. And also, I'm going to put my email in the chat, and feel free to email me if you're interested in like continuing these conversations and continue meetings and maybe even trying to kind of operationalize a little bit of the ideas that we talked about today in a way that can start to be applied in music schools around the country.
Thanks so much, Samuel. Okay, I saw Professor Rabideau wanted to say something, and then Professor Jenkins.
Yeah, it was just at the end of Dr. Geary's comment is we can both mourn the losses that we'll endure as we change and celebrate the successes of a much better future in preparing artists to be impactful in our communities and around the world. So they don't have to be mutually exclusive. There's gonna be loss, but there's a really bold idea out there, and I think we could be part of that.
I just wanted to say something just to Black students in particular, since there are probably many Black students on this call and I feel best positioned to speak to Black students. We are in a political space where conservatories are telling you that they want you, where they are actively recruiting Black students. And, you know, the experience of Black America is one of such profound and consistent marginalization that it can be really difficult to imagine what it would be like for our narrative to be centralized. But I would encourage you, as you're being recruited by schools, to insist that your narrative is centralized, or at least imagine what it would feel like to do that, and to then put pressure on your school to see how they can do that. That's the only way, or one of the best ways in which change is actually going to come about.
Thank you so much. And Professor Fitzpatrick, Professor Sands, anything?
I would just add that, you know, I mean, I think we need to both make a commitment to rapid attention to many of these issues which have been ignored for so long. This is the time where we cannot ignore these issues any longer in higher education, but we also need to be prepared to sustain these efforts long-term, because we owe that to our students, we owe that to our communities. But that process is not easy, but it's important. So just wanted to say that. Thank you so much.
And yeah, just very quickly, I think good work is being done. It's being done across the country, actually. I ran across a webpage that came from the studio instructors at Juilliard, where they had done the research and put together a database of music by Black composers that they were implementing and using in their studio repertoires. So I think the work is happening, and as you said, we just have to, you know, help it continue and help it to expand.
Yes, and Bill.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure people saw that I placed in the chat a link for today's 5 p.m. discussion, because that will be in a Zoom meeting format, not a webinar. So it'll be open to anyone who's there. And I also posted in the chat the registration page for this weekend's other sessions. So people do need to register for each session individually. Thanks, Paula.
Awesome. Thank you all so much. Professor Sarath, I'll leave you to say any final words.
Got to unmute, Ed.
If this was a baseball lineup, we started with the third number three and the cleanup hitter. It's like the whole all the way. And what a great start, you know. And Mark started us off by asking, you know, for the alignment of music studies with the sound, as he put it, the soundtrack of the communities. And boy, that opened up the floodgates. And so much of what Atma has been predicated on. The celebration of Black American music, not just as a single course, and it's just unbelievable that many schools don't even have a single course for the majority of music majors, certainly the core curriculum, but we're talking about as a fundamental pillar that came out really, really strongly. And the thing I want to emphasize is that Atma's coming out with some very bold initiatives that are going to be actually celebrating the capacity. This is not Black American music versus, say, the European tradition. This is Black music as a foundational pillar that can elevate everything. This is a new frontier. And I'm looking at this panel and it's like, we're so blessed with people like Chris that really have the chops to navigate that. I'm looking at my dear friend, Kate. Hey, Kate, here we are. We're seeing each other in a symposium. K through 12, that theme came up. K through 12 is like low hanging fruit. We could actually, I mean, sure, the political dynamics of changing the core curriculum are really fierce and thick. why not start with K through 12? We could do it immediately. We could do it by the fall. Anyway, these are all, this is what's emerging is a really inclusive celebratory vision. And we have to do some hard work. Also that came through the systemic nature of musical racism. I think that there's a lot of talk about systemic societal racism. We need to stay on that, but we need to really cross the threshold into in my forthcoming book, which, yes, I haven't signed the contract yet, Mark. I have 30 parameters of systemic musical racism. This is like doing an intricate kind of surgery. Finally, thank you so much, Paula Wilson, for facilitating and with your team coming up with brilliant questions. We went deep really fast, and we're going to continue doing this. And thanks again to CMS. Be well, everyone. We're back on at in a couple of hours. 3:30 Eastern time. Thanks, everyone.